We're talking to Merle Roughton, and today is June 20th of 2007. We're here at WILL TV Studio X in Campbell Hall, that's in Urbana, Illinois. And Mr. Roughton, I just want to thank you very much for talking with us today. Can you tell us, you're from Decatur, is that right?
No, I'm from Urbana.
You're from Urbana, and you're living in Decatur now.
I live in Decatur now. Mm-hmm. I went to Urbana High School. When I was a junior in Urbana High School, I signed up in the Illinois National Guard, a horse troop, mm-hmm. a heavy machine gun troop. And it was the 106th Cav, stationed right here in Urbana.
What made you decide to join up the Illinois National Guard at that time?
Well, in those days, things were pretty dull. It wasn't much for a young man to do. It was during the latter part of the Depression, as you know. And a couple of my buddies came around and said that they were moving a horse troop into the Banner Armory from Springfield. And they said they was going to join. Well, they talked me into joining.
Mm-hmm.
The ironic part of this was, when we did leave to go to Camp Livingston later, neither one of them went, and I did. And that's how my career in the Army started.
Mm-hmm.
We served in the National Guard until November of 1940. We came, we were, I don't know how to put that. And can I go back a little bit?
Sure.
Okay. The night, let's see, how'd that go? Oh, after we joined the National Guard in January of 1940, we trained, and the Army in Urbana had a gravel floor mm-hmm. for horses. The floor was about the size of a football field inside in the building. The stables were built in the back of the Armory inside. At the back of it was a big corral where we put the horses during the day, and of course we moved them into the stalls at night in the building.
Mm-hmm.
So we trained there, and of course only about 10 of the men had ever rode a horse before. Finally we got ready to ride the horses. So they brought all the horses in, and we lined them up out there, and they said mount, and you should have seen that. That was something else. Them horses were everywhere but under the men. After a couple of weeks of that, well, we finally got so we could mount the horses.
Mm-hmm.
Then we started riding them outside of the Army. And one of the reasons why we did join in the first place, they said we could ride anytime we wanted to, mm-hmm. go out there and ride. Well, yeah, but you had to clean the horse after you got done. They didn't tell us that, but then we started riding around the countryside. Of course, Hitler was doing his job over there about that time.
Mm-hmm.
In August of 1940, we went to Camp McCoy, Wisconsin.
So you were already, as part of the National Guard then, you were called up into Wisconsin at Camp McCoy,
we went up there every year, the National Guard did.
I see.
When we got up there, we didn't take our horses with us. We went up on a train. Now, our horses were cavalry trained. When they said 4 foot from head to croup, that horse, the cavalry horse, knew what that was. Most people don't know what that means if I told them.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, when we got up to Wisconsin, we had remounts. Now, these horses have been broke and turned to pasture. These horses were not ready for cavalry riding.
Mm-hmm.
We soon found that out. I drew a horse. It was about the size of the Empire State Building. And that horse never walked a day of its life. It was a trotter, mm-hmm. continually. Well, not only did the men all get dysentery, but my horse also got dysentery.
Oh, no.
Yes. And it lost much weight. I lost my saddle blanket at one time and had to ride back 5 miles to pick my saddle blanket up. Well, I got a sore in my leg. Now, I don't know where most people know it, but horse hair will go right through your pants into your leg.
Oh, wow.
Just like a worm. Well, my horse hair got into my knee infection, and so they took me off of riding for a little bit, but put me on KP duty. I'd rather ride the horse, which was terrible anyway, but so So we rode, and finally, the last day, we were something like 72 miles out, someone said, and we had a forced march back to camp. Now, that's a long ride on a horse.
Mm-hmm.
And we rode, we started out one morning and ended up the next evening, I think it was. And, of course, the kitchen had closed. You got to take care of that horse before you go eat or do anything.
Mm-hmm.
The horse comes first.
Mm-hmm.
While he was up there, we had a lightning storm. Well, we tied the horses to a picket line, which is a rope stretched out and tied on each end.
Right.
Of course, the horses run away with the picket line. I mean, we had to go gather the horses up. Every evening, we had to water those horses, take them to water.
Mm-hmm.
Some people rode them. I never done that. I put a halter on and take it. You could never tell what they was going to do. Some would get right down there and just stop.
Mm-hmm.
You couldn't force them to drink water. Others would run right out in the middle with you on them or leading them. And that was about the extent of that. When we came back from...
Can I ask you, how old were you at that time?
I was 17 years old when I started. I was 18 by the time I got back.
Mm-hmm. And how long of a time was that that you were up at Camp McCoy?
Normally it was 2 weeks, and this year, 1940, was three. Mm-hmm. We was up for 21 days.
Mm-hmm.
We had some peculiar times up there. They gave us new denims, which is fatigue clothes, and, if you know what fatigue clothes are, and they were blue.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they wasn't dyed right or something, because it rained on them and we turned blue.
Oh, gee.
We looked like something else. We also had a bonfire in the middle of the street. We had tents, six-man tents, not like a camp, but tents.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, and we had a bonfire in the middle of the street. Somebody threw a bunch of blanks in the bonfire. Now, let me tell you, some boys got some shrapnel there, not serious, of course,
mm-hmm.
but they overcame that. And then everybody got dysentery, and, you know, we weren't used to washing our mess kits like we did later on, and the dip system. And then when we came back from Wisconsin, we rode patrol at the county fair. We rode the fences out here. Before we went up there, though, I forgot to mention, we paraded down Main Street in Urbana. And to this day, I can't find any pictures of that. And I can't believe that they didn't take pictures.
Mm-hmm.
I do not have one picture of me when I was in horse cavalry.
Mm-hmm.
Now, our machine guns were mounted on pack horses. The mount, the gun, and the tripod, and the water jugs. You said water jugs? They were water cooled.
Mm-hmm.
And the ammo.
That was packed on the horses.
Packed on pack horses, yes.
Mm-hmm.
We led them pack horses.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know when these saddles were made, but it had to be Spanish-American War sometime back there.
Mm-hmm.
They were supposed to have snap-over connectors on them. Well, they no longer held them. The horses would get to jumping, and of course they'd throw the gun off or the ammo or the water. And then we'd tie them on there. Well, you'd be riding along, they'd say, dismount and set your gun up, of course, and we'd have to untie them.
Mm-hmm.
That was one of the problems we had was with the equipment we had then. But then when we came back, we was in, of course, in station, which is Urbana. And a little later on, evidently, the draft notice came out that there was going to be a draft. I can't prove it by me, because we didn't know that. But it seemed like the next meeting after we got back in August, we went out to the Army for our training, which we had once a month. And it was full of men signing up.
Okay, so this was still in 1940.
This is still in 1940. This before he was federalized. That was the word I was looking for a while ago. But anyway, the halls were full of men taking their physicals. There was farmers, people from the University of Illinois, students. They were trying to beat the draft. Well, literally, they didn't know that this outfit was going to be called way before the draft ever got around to it.
Mm-hmm.
So we signed up. I don't know how many. I can't tell you how many men we signed up there.
Mm-hmm.
They are not in that book, if you use the book for...
Okay.
They're not in that. In November of 1940, they took our horses away, and we became a service troop. And the reason for that was they had to have a big organization to drive the vehicles that carried the horses and the men. The mm-hmm. cavalry was then going to become a horse mechanized outfit.
Okay.
We were going into federal duty. We stayed at the Urbana Armory. We stationed there mm-hmm. from November 24th, I think it was, 1940.
Mm-hmm.
We left New Year's Eve for Camp Livingston, Louisiana,
mm-hmm.
for our training.
And now, you were still in high school at that time,
that's right.
though. So what did your family think about that? I mean, that you were going to leave with this cavalry group.
I wasn't really interested in school, and a lot of people wasn't. You know, this war was coming on, and by that time we realized something was happening. When we first got in, you know, we paid a little attention to what was going on.
Mm-hmm.
A little later on, when we started drilling more often and riding out through the countryside and that, we realized that something was coming on.
Mm-hmm.
Coming off.
Right. Because the war was happening in Europe and in England at the time, but
in 39, it was Poland, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, in November of, I think it was 24th, we were federalized. Army of the United States. Not the United States Army, but Army of the United States, which is reserves. Either be it National Guard or regular reserves. I don't know, ROTC, I don't know whether they're in that or not, but anyway.
So before that, it was considered the Illinois National Guard, the 106th Cavalry of Illinois
National Guard. The 33rd Division of mm-hmm. the Illinois mm-hmm. National Guard. We had two squadrons. After we changed in November,
mm-hmm.
we had a horse squadron and we had a mechanized squadron. They had armored cars. And that's the way it was when we got to Camp Livingston, Louisiana. The horse troops were from Chicago. They're originally started by polo players.
Hmm.
And they done parades and when dignitaries came in, they played for them and that. They were mounted. Mm-hmm. They were horse mounted. And most of them owned horses, and they were called the Black Horse Troops.
Mm-hmm.
And so then they were federalized also at the same time because they was part of the 106.
Okay.
The cavalry was changing at that time.
Mm-hmm.
It was going from a mechanized and a horse to a horse mechanized. And then we spent the year in Camp Livingston, we went to the 41 Louisiana maneuvers and done our training there. A funny thing happened. They had 77 semis, which they called portées.
Mm-hmm.
They hauled 8 horses and 8 men and their equipment, 77 of them. That was for the horse troops. Now, service group, the troop I was in, was the drivers for those portées.
Okay.
So they called them. Well, at that time, equipment was slow to come to the National Guard outfits. A lot of them were going in at that time, being called in to active duty. Well, the men that was in that platoon that drove those semis didn't have anything to do. Only the trailers came.
Mm-hmm.
The tractors didn't come, so they had nothing to do. They go down there and paint and tighten and nuts and bolts, and they done that, I don't know for how long, maybe a month.
Mm-hmm.
Finally, the tractors came. So a lot of them have been semi-drivers in civilian life. So they all get hooked up and start to pull off, and they, all the trailers were sliding. The brakes was locked on them.
Oh, no.
In their efforts to tighten everything, they had also tightened the brakes up on all of them. This is a fact.
Keeping busy.
Oh, yeah, but we got over that. And then we got into the part about us wearing boots and breeches. Now, our boots at that time were lace boots, mm-hmm. and our breeches were also lace. At Reveille in the morning, you had about 15 minutes to get ready for Reveille. There ain't no way you can lace your breeches and lace your boots in 15 minutes. So we used to wear our overcoat to hide the fact that we didn't have our boots and breeches on. That was one of the things we done.
So that was the uniform, even though you weren't actually riding horses all the time at that point, right? You were...
Well, we was no longer a horse troop anyway.
Mm-hmm.
When we went into active duty, we became a service troop, and they took horses away from us.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was a fine day.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I drove. I never even had a driver's license at that time, and they issued me a sick with safe. I don't, most people knows what one of those is.
They issued you a what?
6x6. Big truck.
Oh.
I never drove a truck before. One of those guys had and said, there it is, you drive it.
Okay.
Well, when we originally got down there, we didn't draw as many as we should. We only got about 6. We should have had about 30, I guess. So we drove them night and day.
Mm-hmm.
The only good part about what that was, we didn't have to stay in KP. But one of the bad things we also had to do was haul the manure from the horses. We hauled it to a veterans hospital in the area.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember going to a veterans hospital. On the way over was a women's prison, not a prison, one of those, like a detention camp.
Okay.
And every time we'd go back, they'd holler and whistle. Every time we'd go by, and we always swore we were going to go over there and see him, but of course we never did.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this went on until, by the way, when we got to Camp Livingston, Louisiana, the streets were not ready. It was solid mud. And we were in 6-man tents with screen sides, wood floors, mm-hmm. and a space heater.
This was in the winter too, right? This was in...
Well, we got down there in... Yeah, we got down there in January.
Mm-hmm.
1941. 41, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And but they had space heaters. They wasn't cold, but it was cold outside. I don't care what people say about Louisiana being warm. It ain't warm in the winter.
Mm-hmm.
Well, of course, we done all that training, had the maneuvers, and when war was declared, we was all at the movie that night. I can remember. We just got a movie. And it was probably a half mile from the camp, and so they turned on the lights and said, everybody would report back to your outfit. By the way, the 106th Cavalry was far away from all the other troops in that camp, for obvious reasons.
The obvious reason is?
The horse manure.
Oh, okay.
Which goes along with the cavalry.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, we got back, so they roll the outfit that night, and they take over all the bridges between Alexandria and New Orleans.
Hmm.
Because that, you can understand that would deter movement on the highways of anybody that tried to come into the United States.
Right. Now, this was after Pearl Harbor,
this
then.
This was December the 8th.
Of
7th and 8th.
Of 1941.
That's correct.
Right after when they
declared. We'd already
war.
Been in over a year.
Okay.
Of active duty.
Mm-hmm.
So, being in transportation and driving 6x6, and most of the time supplies and stuff like that, they didn't need us right that night. And the next couple of days, they had other outfits come in and take over the bridges.
Mm-hmm.
The reason they used cavalry because it's mounted.
Mm-hmm.
It was mechanized. You know, they had the vehicles to get the men there.
Mm-hmm.
So after that ended, our colonel was nice and said, my outfit's ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
So they split the outfit. They took the mechanized part with part of headquarters and part of service and left the horse troops in Camp Livingston and shipped the mechanized part to Panama.
Mm-hmm. And you were in the mechanized part?
I was in service troop, but mm-hmm. they needed part of service in the mechanized part. We serviced both, the horse troops and the mechanized part, but they had to have some in part of headquarters.
Mm-hmm. Can you explain to me what you mean by service troop? What is that?
Service troop is supply, transportation.
Okay.
In fact, we drove them into town.
Okay.
At night. We'd drive all day, and then at night we'd drive them into town, you know,
mm-hmm.
and park down on the levee. And when there's curfew, we'd drive them back to Camp Livingston.
Mm-hmm. So when you started, you didn't even have a driver's license, but you wound up being a driver.
In the end, yes, I became a driver.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we went down to Pontchartrain Beach. I know you've heard of Pontchartrain.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, it was a resort area and was supposed to be a POE. Well, this was the port of the days of POE, really, port of embarkations.
Okay.
We had tents in, but these tents didn't have wooden sides nor screens. These were just six-man tents.
Mm-hmm.
And let me tell you, it was cold down there. We liked to froze to death.
Mm-hmm.
It was probably the 5th. So anyway, we got a pass and went into New Orleans, but New Orleans at that time was practically closed down.
Mm-hmm.
Right after that. It was the darkest place I ever went. So we came back to camp. The next morning, we walked to 7 miles to the port, and they loaded us on this converted cattle boat, and we took off out through the Caribbean.
Mm-hmm.
We ended up in Panama,
right,
because they thought that was going to be the next destination of the war.
And why did they think that?
Cut your Navy in two.
Mm-hmm. Because part of the Navy was in Hawaii, and
well, part of it was on the West Coast, part of it was on the East Coast.
Okay.
So you couldn't go through the canal. You had to go down through by the Cape, mm-hmm. South America.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it was important.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we did not patrol the canal zone itself.
Okay.
We patrolled the interior.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Panama is a mountainous country, most of it. The Colon side, which is the Caribbean side, has very little level land or road. We didn't have many men on that side.
Mm-hmm.
But on the Panama side, which is the Pacific side, we had a road that runs from the north to the south, except out to the head on the country, and then the Chapo River, that was the end.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing we was doing while we was in Panama, they was building the third locks, so they could take bigger ships.
Okay.
They was also building the Alaskan-South American highway.
Okay.
They had parts of it done, but none of the bridges. They were all detours.
Mm-hmm.
At that time. There was no civilian work going on, mm-hmm. in the interior at that time. And that was our job. We patrolled from, that was in January of 1942 till August of 1943, which mm-hmm. is almost 2 years.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. From January 42 to August of 43, you said. Okay.
See, that's almost.
Right, right.
What, 3 months?
Did you get to go home at all during that time?
No.
Okay.
That's another story. When we was in Camp Livingston, we'd been there almost a year, and we all came up for furlough.
Mm-hmm.
So we came home, a bunch of us from Urbana and Champaign.
Mm-hmm.
That's where we were all from.
Mm-hmm.
We was home 4 days, and they called us back.
Oh.
Pennsylvania coal strike. Well, when a war's on the horizon, you sure don't want a coal strike.
Right.
And we were going to run to Pennsylvania to break up the coal strike, you know, by orders of the president. Of course, mm-hmm. they used cavalry because cavalry is mounted, you know, especially the mechanized part. They can get there in a hurry.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they called us back.
Mm-hmm.
It never happened. We never got that go back home, though, again.
Oh.
Pearl Harbor happened before we got mm-hmm. to come go back home.
So you were only about 18. When that happened.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm.
I was about 18 years old.
Was that hard not to be able to go home?
Well, no. And that's one of the benefits of being in the National Guard outfit. All your buddies were there.
Mm-hmm.
There must have been 20 guys from the East End of Urbana. I went to school with. Was going to school with.
Mm-hmm.
Were in the outfit. Mm-hmm. You was You was at home. It wasn't that bad.
Mm-hmm. You were all in there with your buddies instead of having strangers from all over the place.
That's right.
In the group together. Mm-hmm.
That's, like I say, it's one of the advantages of being a National Guard out. Mm-hmm. Esprit de Corps was out of this world. They had more Esprit de Corps than I ever saw in any other outfit while I was in the service.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was a proud outfit. It had, from World War One, I think it had five battle stars, maybe it's six. It's on that emblem.
Mm-hmm.
It was an old outfit.
Mm-hmm.
And they had patrolled also on the border, the 106th had back in the early 1900s.
Mm-hmm. So you were down in Panama for almost 2 years, a year and a half definitely. And then where did you go after that?
And they shipped us back to the States to San Francisco, went under the Golden Gate Bridge and pulled up the docks and stuff. At the foot of a street that goes up the hill. What's right. that called? We all clapped, ma'am, we're going to get to go into town.
Uh-huh.
We walked across the dock and got on a tugboat and went up the Sacramento River to Pittsburgh, which is Camp Stoneman. And there they deliced us and dipped us and took our clothes away from us and all that because we're coming out of a tropical country.
Okay.
They do that when you come out of a tropical country and the issue is new clothes and everything. Then we got on a train. 5 days it took us to go from Pittsburgh, California to Paris, Texas, where that was Camp Maxey, Texas, was our next station.
So you didn't get to see San Francisco?
No.
Okay.
We didn't get to do that. Well, then we, like I say, we ended up Maxey. Well, the outfit we came from originally had gotten rid of the horses, and they got another squadron, and they were still in Texas. Now, they'd been in Texas all that time we had been overseas.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted to ship us immediately overseas again. The same reason, seasoned troops.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they came down and gave us a core test, which is tell you what how good the outfit was, and of course, we didn't pass it. Mm-hmm. We didn't want to go overseas again. We wanted to go home on furlough.
Okay.
And we was a little perturbed at that outfit. They had their wives and everything down in Texas. We hadn't seen anybody yet.
Mm-hmm.
We hadn't even been home.
Mm-hmm.
Also, they took one of us out each of the troops and sent us to Louisiana to the maneuvers again as umpires.
Mm-hmm.
And we'd done that. Then we came back. We did come home, and you've seen the pictures in the book of reunion had when we all came home together.
Mm-hmm.
And then we went back together. And when we got back, they were still trying to get the outfit to pass the core test. About that time, I went to Fort Raleigh to mechanic school.
Mm-hmm.
And I missed most of that, thank goodness.
Can you tell me what a core test is? I'm not sure I understand what that is.
They check your combat readiness is what it does.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know the gun you got? Can you do this? Can you do that? What is this? You know, what maneuver would you do? All this is a part of that core test.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, thank goodness I wasn't there most of the time I was in school in Fort Raleigh. And when I got back, the outfit was getting ready to go overseas. What they done is they sent a guy from Washington to take over the outfit. And he came down and said, I'm going to take this outfit overseas. That's not quite the words he used, but
okay. That's
what it amounted to. And he says, my name is Mark A. Devine, and I'm anything but. That's when we was part of the 14th. We joined the 18th to make a group and became the 32nd Squadron of the 14th Cav Group. And that's in August, we shipped overseas and landed in Glasgow, Scotland. We was on the Queen, like I told you.
Mm-hmm.
And landed in Glasgow, Scotland, going on a train, walked and rode the length of England to Bournemouth, which is on the southern coast of England. Resort town, if you're familiar with it.
What was the name of it again?
Bournemouth.
Bournemouth, okay.
Down by Portsmouth.
So this was in August of 44.
That's correct.
Right? Okay.
August of 44.
Mm-hmm.
I seen the White Cliffs of Dover. I also see the rocks, the...
Stonehenge?
Stonehenge.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, being a young guy at that time, it didn't really impress me, you know, history. History was my fort right then.
Uh-huh.
Now, we didn't take any equipment overseas but two vehicles, believe it or not. Uh-huh. And they were Otograph Jeeps. Now, an Otograph is a map maker, and it's mounted in a Jeep, and wherever you go with this machine makes a map of it.
Okay.
See, reconnaissance.
Okay.
That's why, and then the only two vehicles we took overseas. In fact, that's how I got to go into New York before anybody else did, because we had to transport them down to Brooklyn Navy Yards to be shipped overseas.
Mm-hmm.
And they put one of them in the back of a 6x6, and I drove the other one and followed. The guy who was driving the 6x6 was a taxi driver in New York.
Okay.
He'd go through on a yellow light, I'd go through on a red light, and we was up in upper New York, came down through New Jersey and through the Holland Tunnel into Brooklyn Navy Yards.
Uh-huh.
Of course, it took us all night to get back. He never ever beer joined in New York City, and we stopped at every one of them, almost. All the rest of the troops were back there. They couldn't go to town.
Mm-hmm.
Later, they let us out one evening before we shipped.
Mm-hmm. So how long do you think that was? Several weeks that you were in New York? Or
no.
No, short time.
Maybe 3 or 4 days.
Okay.
Just in time, get you ready.
Mm-hmm.
That was a POE, port mm-hmm. of embarkation. When you was there, you know, you was going overseas.
Right. So things were starting to heat up pretty much over in Europe at the time. So you knew, kind of had an idea what you were getting into, or?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Then we drew our equipment. They had the equipment stored all over England. We drove all over the.
Mm-hmm.
To pick it all up.
Okay.
It was amazing. They had it all hid. And then we formed up and got on the LSD and went across the English Channel. It was the roughest ride that ever took them alive.
Mm-hmm.
It was rough, and we didn't go across in one day. And that thing was rolling. We lost the armored car off the upper deck.
Oh.
It broke its tie down chain. Mm-hmm. And rolled off the upper deck. It was that rough.
Mm-hmm.
And then we landed in Omaha Beach, went up into the hedgerows, and our colonel, this wonderful colonel, had his picture of pup tents. And that's the first time I voted, too. I'll never forget that. It was raining, absentee ballot, vote for Roosevelt.
Oh, okay. So that was in...
44.
Mm-hmm. In November, then.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then we moved up through Paris, and up in the central part of France. And then we moved up into Luxembourg, and the 32nd was down in the Saar Valley, going across the, I can't think of the river now, doing recon work for the right flank of the 1st Army, and the 18th Squadron, the other squadron of that group, was up north of Luxembourg. They're the ones that caught the Battle of the Bulge. That's where it started.
Mm-hmm.
They had taken, I think it was 4 infantry divisions out. Maybe that could be wrong. Maybe it was 3. And put these probably 800 cavalrymen in there to hold that front.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the Germans wasn't dumb. And the night before the Battle of the Bulge, the 32nd, moved out of they'd been down there for 3 or 4 months down in the Saar Valley doing recon work across the Moselle River down there.
Mm-hmm.
And we moved up to refurbish our machinery and get new men and mm-hmm. all that. Well, it never happened, because that night I met all my old buddies from Urbana, and we went, there was a local tavern was open then, believe it or not.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful girl in there waiting. Never forget that.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a ball that night. And the next day, the Battle of the Bulge started.
Mm-hmm. So there was the 18th Squadron, but you said you were in...
I was in the 32nd Squadron.
Which
was the nucleus of it was the Springfield Champaign-Urbana men.
Okay.
When the war was over, I claim we still had about 400 of them left.
Mm-hmm.
But people say, well, that ain't so, but there's no way to prove that.
Mm-hmm.
There was a lot of us left.
Mm-hmm.
There was a lot of them on that train when we come down from Chicago, too,
mm-hmm.
except for three. Mm-hmm. The three you seen that picture that we stayed up in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
We missed the train.
You missed the train. Okay.
We were all neighbors anyway. We didn't. Mm-hmm. We was going to have a little fun.
You caught up with it eventually.
Yeah. Well, the outfit after the Battle of Bulge, we pulled back to a little town called Kamexi, refurbished, drew new men, and went right back up through the same place.
Mm-hmm.
Right through the same towns. You know, the parts that we'd seen when we pulled back were long gone. Everything demolished, you know.
Uh-huh.
And then went down, and finally we joined, after we crossed the Rhine River with the 7th Armored, I think it was, we drew our new tanks, 24s, with a bigger gun on it, and we joined Patton. Patton was going to make a run for down south toward the Danube and toward Czechoslovakia and Austria.
Mm-hmm.
And he wanted cavalry, of course. He's going to make that long run. The other one was a short run across to Berlin on the upper part of Germany.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, we got just to the Austrian border and the war ended. So we pulled back to a town by the name of Erlangen. And mm-hmm. our outfit was going to go over. So we would recondition our vehicles so we could turn them in, and our outfit was going to go to South Pacific. So they took the high pointers. Points for longevity and that,
mm-hmm.
and transferred them to an infantry outfit for quarters and rations till they could get a ship back to the States.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the outfit left to go to South Pacific, came back to the States, and the men got a terminal leave. Oh, no, not a terminal. Well, they got a leave.
Okay.
And we were still over there waiting on a ship in France.
Okay.
Well, we finally got a ship in August, and guess when BJ Day came along where we were. We was on the high seas.
Oh, okay.
Most of the men that came back with the outfit with the low pointers were recruits, and the rest of them had come in late in the outfit.
Mm-hmm.
They were already discharged.
Okay. I was doing a little bit of research because I wanted to try to understand what the cavalry did, and, you know, It's. I understand that they were sort of, and mechanized, their role was sort of the same as the traditional role of light cavalry, in that they were sort of the eyes and the ears of the army, and they were scouting out ahead of some of the slower, heavier equipped units, and the cavalry's job was to seek out the enemy and determine their strength and their position and then report back,
mm-hmm.
and the cavalry would also move between units, allied armies or different units within the army to try to keep people in touch with each other. And
yeah, they pulled the planks.
Mm-hmm. And you were equipped as lightly as possible so that you could get in and out of combat areas.
That's correct.
Now, is that
of course,
what you experienced? Or?
Yes. In my books over there is a thing that tells the whole story of it. Of course, that was their primary objective. That ain't the way they used them all the time.
Okay.
They use them for combat and every other thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, quick hit.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, Patton, he used them to go ahead till you're hit and stop and report and go on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we go through the towns and then let the infantry come along behind them and wipe up. This was after we crossed the Rhine, of course.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Germany was done. It was terrible at that time.
Mm-hmm. What kind of vehicle were you on then when you were actually in France?
I was commander of a wrecker, a big wrecker.
Okay.
And I had two men from the 104th Division, which is the Pennsylvania National Guard, was my driver, and the other one was my riding mechanic. It rode three men in the cab.
Mm-hmm.
It seemed to me like we always had a half track on the back. You know, something happened to it, blew a track off of it, or it blew a wheel off, or
mm-hmm.
something happened to it. We always would pull one around on the back, it seemed like.
Okay.
But more or less, we were very few times were with the platoon, because the line companies would have something like that happen, and of course we'd get in a wreck and go get them. As a matter of fact, one of the probably the worst things we done was the morning of the 16th, which is the morning the Battle of the Bulge started. They sent us from Vilsom, which is about 7 miles from St. Vith, up to get a half track, as it hit a mine, blew a track. Mm-hmm. As we went down the road toward St. Vith, there was no vehicles going our way. Everything was going the other way. Mm-hmm. If you read the journals on the Battle of the Bulge, that's about the way it was the first 2 days of it. Mm-hmm. But we didn't know that. There was no radio in that wrecker. Mm-hmm. We knew where to go get the wrecker, mm-hmm. or go get the half track. It was a half track. Mm-hmm. So it was up St. Vith. I remember pulling into St. Vith, and it had a bunch of, on one side of the road, it had a bunch of brick houses. And the people were still in. Mm-hmm. And they were trying to run out of the doors, trying to get out, and the MPs were chasing them back in.
Okay.
They wanted them to get blocked the traffic. The Red Ball Express had vacated their supply vehicles, parked right alongside the road, and took off. Mm-hmm. The artillery up on the right side, up in an orchard, when it was a hill, were firing direct fire across the railroad yards all the way over on the bluff on the other side. Mm-hmm. Well, our half track was down in the railroad yard. Sure enough, he had a track off on one side. He had about 6 or 7 men with him. Mm-hmm. It was a maintenance platoon. I forget which one of the letter companies it was. Probably C. But anyway, the track was off. They had the hood up and the engine running. Mm-hmm. They were cooking their dinner.
Oh, okay.
The Heinies were up on the hill, well, up on the bluff on the other side. We pulled down there, and I said, Pappy, that's the guy's nickname. I'm not going to tell you his last name.
Okay.
He was from the Pennsylvania National Guard also. And he said, don't you know the Heinies are coming? He said, yeah, well, what am I going to do? I can't go nowhere. Normally, we would have left it set there. Mm-hmm. But there was no transportation on the wrecker on the back. Mm-hmm. You know, had the booms went out, there was no place to set. So I said, well, we better hook on. You know, get you out of here, mm-hmm. and your men. You ride in the tow vehicle. We didn't normally do that, like to tow people in, but this was a different case.
You had to get them out of there.
And we did. Mm-hmm. And we got on back with the big problem. We couldn't run over about 5 miles an hour. We was running on the bogey wheels. Didn't have a track on one side. Half track's got tracks in the back and wheels in the front. Mm-hmm. 5 miles an hour, you know, we're all stupid. You know, after we pulled up out of those railroad yards, I don't remember no more till the 25th of December.
Really? Why do you think that, why is that blanking out for you?
Well, it was a bad time. I just don't remember it.
But you were fired on then.
Well, everything else, and it was so cold. Mm-hmm. You know, like I say, if you're wounded, in so many cases, the wound itself was not what killed you. Mm-hmm. You froze to death. Mm-hmm. And you'd see the people along, and the soldiers froze mm-hmm. along the road. They couldn't get to cover. Mm-hmm. This was a big thing during the Battle of the Bulge. It was terrible weather.
Mm-hmm. Right. You said that to me earlier, that it was just one of the worst winters ever. And
it was a bad winter, all right. Mm-hmm. And the cavalry was never equipped to dig foxholes nor get in them. Mm-hmm. We did. Mm-hmm. So normally we wouldn't be in that position. We'd mm-hmm. be in the wheel vehicle position, ready to go, mm-hmm. ready to move out. Mm-hmm. But the 18th was in the trenches mm-hmm. and foxholes.
The 18th was, what was
the other squadron.
Okay.
There's two squadrons, there's about 800 men in a squadron, mm-hmm. more or less. Mm-hmm. They're equipped the same way. Mm-hmm. And they usually work for corps, which is a corps is part of the army, bigger than a division. It may have couple, three divisions, and maybe some We happened to be in an airborne. We pulled recon work for 82nd Airborne and some of the other airborne outfit, plus a lot of the regular divisions.
Recon work was, can you tell me a little bit about what that was?
You said it a while ago. That's what we done. Go up there and peek at them, and if you could, get out of there. Mm-hmm. It was not our job to engage. It was, however, they did engage. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because you're a general and you want something done, sometimes they ain't particular who they use to do it. Mm-hmm. And, of course, we were fast and move long distances, faster than anybody else. Mm-hmm. Of course, Patton, you know, was an ex-cavalryman.
Okay.
So, and so we were discharged. That's about the way it was.
Mm-hmm. So after the part where you're trying to, you're saying you don't really remember exactly what happened after that, it was kind of a difficult time. And then at the near the end of the Battle of the Bulge, What did you do at that point? What was your group doing at that point?
It didn't end until January. I forget the exact date. By the third day, our outfit was decimated. Mm. Both squadrons. We all separated in different directions. A lot of our men were captured. So we pulled back. That's when we pulled back into Belgium to regroup, draw new men.
Okay.
And new equipment. Well, the 18th drew the new tanks. They were heavier fortified, bigger guns, light tanks. These are light tanks. Mm-hmm. And we still had the old ones. We had enough of our equipment left. But remember, I said the 18th were in foxholes and trenches. Mm-hmm. That's not the way the cavalry normally fights. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of firepower in our vehicles. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was reading there were two kinds of vehicles that the cavalry used mostly. There were the ones that were mounted with machine guns, the Bantam Jeep, and then there was something called the armored car, or called a Greyhound.
Yes.
Yeah, and then
we didn't have the armored cars there.
No, you didn't. Okay.
We had them in Panama. Mm-hmm. They were wheel vehicles. Mm-hmm. By that time, they were obsolete. We had armored cars in. Well, they called the M8 armored car Greyhound. Mm-hmm. The Brits did. We didn't call it that.
Oh, you didn't? Okay.
We called it an M8. Mm-hmm. It was an M8 armored car. Mm-hmm. It had 6 drive wheels. Mm-hmm. It had only a 37 on it. Light armor. Mm-hmm. And a personnel about the best, mm-hmm. as was half tracks, you know. They were armored too. Mm-hmm. But we had a company of light tanks. All the troops were called troops except the tank company. Mm-hmm. I never did figure that out, why they done it that way, but they were light tanks. They had 2 Cadillac engines in them and a 37 mounted. Mm-hmm. It was a kind of a pea shooter when you're up against a German Tiger with an 88 on it. Mm-hmm. They had a terrific gun, but our vehicles could outmaneuver them anytime.
Okay. That was your advantage then?
That was the advantage. Mm-hmm. Especially the cavalry. Mm-hmm. Speed, like you said, speed and maneuverability.
Mm-hmm. So towards the end of the Battle of Bulge, when everybody was scattered, then how did you come back together? And
Well, of course, the cavalry has a lot of radios. Mm-hmm. They could get in touch with different places. The biggest problem we had was the Germans had captured a lot of the equipment and were using it against us. Uh-huh. It wasn't abnormal to see one of our vehicles coming down the line toward us, but it didn't have our men in it.
Oh, no.
That's correct, especially during the Battle of the Bulge. Mm-hmm. The Germans had a troop of, most of them were former Americans of German heritage, was in this outfit. I forget that Tverskowski or something that was the man's name. Mm-hmm. They all spoke English. They'd all lived in the United States.
Mm-hmm. And then they went back and fought for Germany.
And they were the ones that manned those vehicles.
Okay.
Because when we stopped them, you know, at roadblocks, they could go by. Of course, they did only until we found out what was going on, which there was no, nobody knew what anybody was doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there was no, most of the men that from the rear part of the 14th were gathered in by, I think the man's name was Jones, and made a fighting unit, and we moved down toward Bastogne, if you know what Bastogne is.
Mm-hmm.
I know everybody knows what Bastogne is.
Well, I don't really know what
101st
it is.
Division, that's the, what they call that show. Anyway, Bastogne is that town.
Okay.
And we moved down that way, which was the wrong way, but of course we didn't know it then.
Mm-hmm.
I never found out most of this till I read the book,
mm-hmm.
A Time for Trumpet.
Mm-hmm. So while you were there and in the middle of it, it was kind of hard to know what all was going on. You didn't, yeah.
Well, nobody knew anything.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing you knew was what the guy next to you was doing.
Mm-hmm. And you were with a lot of your buddies from Champaign-Urbana.
Actually, in the early part of that, I was manning the bazooka, and the man in the foxhole with me was from the Pennsylvania National Guard.
Mm-hmm.
He was a little Dutchman,
mm-hmm.
if you know what I mean. You know what a Pennsylvania Dutchman is.
Oh, okay.
That's what I'm talking about.
Okay.
Typical. Little, short, chunky, big mustache.
Mm-hmm.
And he was my loader on bazooka. He loaded the shell and fired it. You know, we was in that pile. Oh, it was terrible. God, it was so miserable. Anyway, he said, you know, he called me Rotor. And he said, you know, I really understand this language. I said, yeah, lay it on me. Now, this is, you imagine where we was. He says, Mercedes-Benz 7-cylinder. I said, yep, you got her down pat. The language.
Yeah.
But my record driver was also a Pennsylvania Dutch, and he could speak it as good as they could.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think a lot of the people there were German speakers originally.
Especially
so.
Mm-hmm. In that part around Luxembourg.
Mm-hmm.
We were at one time stationed in a football field, soccer field to us. But
mm-hmm.
down below, down the hill, was an ex-Chevrolet dealer and his wife. Well, of course, he didn't have no cars, so they opened a tavern there. And we used to go down this hill and talk to him.
Mm-hmm.
And the people from around there came in and talked to us. The people were still in Luxembourg. Luxembourg was a neutral.
Okay. And they never left. They just stayed at their homes.
Yeah, one of the first ring battles then was in the eastern part of Luxembourg.
Mm-hmm.
The saloons and all that were still open.
Mm-hmm.
There's both sides.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But we got to meet this guy. We was there for, well, let's see, we got there, stayed there till December, probably 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
And that was headquarters for the 14th
mm-hmm.
group. And mm-hmm. they had one up north and one down south.
Mm-hmm.
And we got to meet the people. And when I went on past to Paris, I stopped back down there to see the people. They had a big banquet for me.
When was that?
Well, when the war was over, we pulled back to a little town called Erlangen in Germany. Like I said, to get ready to, we thought we was going to get discharged, but
mm-hmm.
we didn't right then. Anyway, and get our vehicles ready to turn in. You do all the things we had to do. And they asked me if I wanted to go past to Paris. Well, I decided I better see Paris if I was going to do it, so mm-hmm. I went on fast to Paris. What we used to use for money was lenses out of cameras.
Oh, really?
The camera, the only thing that's valuable about a camera is the lens anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Leicas and that.
Mm-hmm.
We get a bag of them and go to Paris, and when you get off the train down there, you have a black marketeer meet you at
okay.
the train. He'd take you upstairs and tell you what he's going to give all your stuff. That's where your money came from you spent.
Mm-hmm. So you got to visit Paris, but then you said something about you went back to visit the
people. I went down
people.
To see the Follies, too,
mm-hmm.
while I was there.
Okay.
I decided I was going to do that.
That was going on
even then.
During the war and right after the war, they were...
That was the first time I'd ever seen women with colored hair. You know, they ride the bicycles down the street. They ate a lot along the curbing, you know, well, outside the buildings. Mm-hmm. You know, there. And and the girls would ride their bicycles up and down the street. They didn't have any car gas for them anyway. So. Mm-hmm. And they had colored hair. Mm-hmm. Now, we thought that was something else.
So women in the United States didn't do that at that time?
Not that I ever seen. Mm-hmm. See, we had never seen a whack till we got back to the, or wave or any of those till we come back to the States in 43. Mm-hmm. We thought that was something else, a woman in uniform. Mm-hmm. Outside of nurses, of course.
Right. So this was, that was bef- that was when you came back from Panama, you mean?
That's
you
went right.
To, right, mm-hmm.
The trouble with Panama was, and I don't like tropical. I don't like Florida for the very reason I was in that type of climate for so long. Mm-hmm. They have two seasons in Panama. In the dry season, it only rains once a day. Mm-hmm. It rains so hard you can't see. Mm-hmm. If you're driving a vehicle, you got to stop. 10 minutes later, it's dry. Mm-hmm. Of course, you ain't dry. They had a lot of snakes and iguanas. They eat iguanas down in Panama. You know what that is. That's a it's a big lizard.
Right. A lot of people get malaria down there?
Well, they did. Mm-hmm. See, that was what happened when they was building the Panama Canal, was malaria. Mm-hmm. And, of course, yellow fever. Now, we took shots in the States before we went down there, yellow fever. And when we took that shot, I said, now go back and get on your bunk. Medics did. Mm-hmm. Of course, we had a medical detachment. And so, well, what for? I said, you'll find out. I went back there, and sure enough, you had the yellow fever, you know. That's what actually happens. That's what you're doing.
Mm-hmm. So you would be sick for some time, day or so? We're going to change the tape.
Go ahead. That time now. Today they say don't want to think so, but
right.
Well, you had to do.
Well, it was a tropical environment, so you were. Yeah. You were, you know.
Well, we was.
Want to replace your salt, probably.
We was stationed in Fort Clayton, which overlooked the Miraflores locks. In other words, we could look right out of the windows on one side of the barracks we was in, brand new barracks, by the way, and see the ships coming through the locks. Mm-hmm. We always knew when an aircraft carrier was going to come through because. Albrook Field was just down the road a little way from us, airfield. And when the aircraft carrier was going to come through the locks, they'd have to take all the airplanes off in order to clear when they was coming through the locks. The first one went through there, they said, knocked all the light posts. Have you ever seen a picture of the canal of the locks? Mm-hmm. They had light posts alongside of it. Mm-hmm. Well, they knocked them all down. But we knew when one was going to come through, we'd see their airplane fly into Albrook Field. Mm-hmm. They better have clearance because there was a gun on every hill.
So when we were talking earlier, you said something about, I said something about the Army Air Corps, and you said that your guys used to call them white sheets.
White sheets.
Right.
They used to sleep on white sheets every night. We never did. Mm-hmm. It's a sad thing to say, but we'd go 6 months without a bath, without a shower. Of course, we used our steel helmets as a bath. You could always tell a veteran in combat, his steel helmet had a big brown spot on top of it, and no mosquito, we call it mosquito netting, it was camouflage, well, it was. Mm-hmm. Didn't have any of that on it. Mm-hmm. Because we'd all burn it up. We washed in it, cooked in it.
Mm-hmm. So it would be right on the fire to heat
it up? Well, yeah, we cooked it right on the fire. Of course, couldn't have stopped the bullet because it took all the temper out, but we wasn't too concerned with that. In a cavalry outfit, everybody carries a Thompson submachine gun. The reason for that being, in the tanks and armored cars, there's not much room for big guns. Mm-hmm. In other words, big rifles. Mm-hmm. When we was in Panama, we carried sidearms besides a rifle. We carried a 45 Colt revolver with the butt of the holster facing forward on your right side.
Mm-hmm.
How did you draw that with your right hand? You didn't. Because in the cavalry, your primary weapon was not that. Your primary weapon was the sword.
Okay.
You drew the sword with your right hand over the top of your left hand, or you cut your arm off. Your left hand, you drew the revolver
mm-hmm.
on horseback.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, on horseback, you couldn't hit anything anyway. When the horse was running, they didn't like the Westerns. But we carried those the full time we was in Panama.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, one... We was out Gargona Beach, was one of the second, I guess it's the second most beautiful beach in the world. There was nobody there because it was wartime.
Mm-hmm.
And but we were there on outpost. We had a camp there. We was out in the field. Anyway, and we decided we'd go alligator hunting.
Okay.
So we took out, of course, we had our sidearms on, our 45s, and we... walking down the beach, and the ammo we had was from World War I, the 45 ammo. So we seen something down the line there, laying on the beach, and we decided to take a shot at see how good we was. And we shot down there a couple rounds, and then one lodged in the barrel of my gun. Well, a boy from Sedora says, "Roughton, let me see that gun." So he took and fired it. Of course, it made a bulge in the barrel of my gun. And every time I had an inspection thereafter, the whoever was inspecting me said, "Roughton, you better start cleaning your gun. It's got dirt in it." Of course, it didn't have dirt. It had a bulge in the barrel. I ain't seen him in a long time.
Uh-huh.
But we didn't find any alligators.
No, no alligators there.
I remember the first time we ran into a sloth.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever seen a sloth?
Only in the zoo.
Now, let me tell you something. You're walking around in the jungle and you run up on one of them things. That's something. Oh, they're weird. You know, they got long hair. And
mm-hmm.
They don't move fast, you know, real slow.
Mm-hmm. But you didn't carry those sidearms when you were in Europe then? That was just
no.
When you were...
I don't know what we did do with them. Evidently, when we left Panama, we turned them in.
Mm-hmm. But that was the traditional cavalry arms then.
Yeah,
was the sword.
You've seen mm-hmm. John Wayne with the gun on this side,
mm-hmm.
butt forward. And the reason it's forward because you don't draw it with your right hand.
Mm-hmm.
I never did find a left-hander to find out how they done it. You know what?
Mm-hmm.
But your primary weapon was your saber.
Mm-hmm. But when you got to Europe, you didn't have sabers
no,
then.
No, we was all armored. I had no. Mm-hmm. I'd never seen a horse. So, well, not on our side anyway.
Mm-hmm.
During the latter part of the offensive, I've seen a lot of German,
mm-hmm.
you know, cattle, horses,
mm-hmm.
Wagons. Ah.
They were running out of armaments at that time, so they were using everything they had.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Boys,
mm-hmm.
Old men.
Mm-hmm.
It was a bad time.
So you weren't wounded though during the Battle of the Bulge.
No,
you managed to avoid that.
Mm-hmm. I never stood in the right place, I guess.
Or you did stand in the right place.
I never wanted to be.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a bad thing for me right now. I can't get anything from the VA
mm-hmm.
because of that.
Mm-hmm.
I can't get medicine because I wasn't wounded. I wasn't captured. I said, if I'd known that, I'd have let it go ahead and take me. Now, I wasn't around Agent Orange, nor did I have a problem from the service.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm at the bottom of the category.
Mm-hmm. But at the time, you were pretty fortunate that you have to do that.
Well, the cavalry in itself, or cavalry, I should say it, the way it was supposed to be used, we was there and then we was gone. You
mm-hmm.
know, I'll hand all to those guys in the trenches. Mm-hmm. No, I was always glad I was never in the infantry. Mm-hmm. Now, we also had a troop of howitzers. Mm-hmm. They call them assault guns, and they were fired. They were on the same chassis as our M5 tanks with 37. They fired like a mortar, you know, a looping, assault weapon, or you know, they was used in that way. If you were going to advance, and they were going to assault in front of you, that they'd use the. And it was called an M8 tank.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We had both of them.
And
we
shoot those to try to clear what was ahead of you.
They lob, more or less lob it like you do a mortar. And that was, they also had two Cadillac engines. And that's the thing my buddy got killed in.
You want to tell me about that?
Or? Mm-mm.
Okay. But a lot of the guys that you were in with made it okay through.
The tent I was in Camp Livingston when we was in training in Louisiana, there was five men and a corporal there. Those five men were all from Urbana, outside of the corporal. Well, he was too, but he didn't go with us. We went to Panama together, we went to Europe together, and this one's the only one that got killed out of that bunch. And we came back together. Those three in that one picture are those three men, and we all live in the east end of Urbana.
Wow, that's great.
Well, you're lucky,
because
it could have turned the other way. They missed the gasoline supply storage on that German tanker. I can't think of his name right now. Anyway, if he'd have got that, we'd have been in trouble.
So where was that? Where were you?
It was in the Battle of the Bulge.
You were near the gas storage area?
Well, no, it was to the rear, but see, he was headed toward, well, he wasn't actually going to go to Liège. He was going south of Liège, going to go up to the port. See, if he got to port where our supplies were coming in, he'd be in trouble. That's a matter of record. You can read that. The thing that most people don't know about is what really happened in the initial part of it. Here's this 18th Cav sitting out there by herself, and the other squadron, which is the 32nd, which we was in, just moving up. And they were in foxholes. That engine, you know, Cavalry was not designed to be in foxholes. Our heavy artillery was on our vehicles, not in the foxholes. Well, we had the 45 Thompsons, but most of us also carried a Garand, which is a rifle. Because Thompson's a short-range gun, you know, no good at long range. But.
But after you were under attack like that, you all went into some trenches too. Then at that time, right when it was so cold and you were.
Yeah. Well, yes, but I never did again after that. After the Battle of Bulge, we never did again. Riding the wrecker had its advantages. Like I said, a lot of the time we were by ourselves, us three. And we was in no man's land and everywhere else, wandering around. But it seemed like we always had a half track hooked on the back. You'd either blow the front wheel off or run over a landmine or something.
And you were always after picking them up and
trying
to get them?
We'd go get them. And then, of course, we'd have to take them to a drop area. And ordnance would pick them up after that.
And they try to repair them and put them back into service, or
When we pulled up on the beach, at Omaha, the tanks were on the bottom, the rest of the vehicles were on the upper surface, the army cars and the trucks and all that of the outfit. The first tank pulled out, went out about 10 feet, and just went whoosh, like that. The LST had pulled up on a sand dune. Well, a sandbar, actually. And on the other side, it was deep. And he let the front down, you know, and you run down that front gate out in the water. That same tank, those guys in the F Troop, which was the tank company, swear that they got that same tank back. That was hard for me to believe. But that wasn't the one I drove across the Rhine River.
Okay.
That was in all the things that I had done. That was the most exciting thing that I ever done. I probably ever will.
Well, why don't you tell me about that?
Well, when we crossed the Rhine, after we crossed the bridge, the Remagen Bridge, our outfit went across it when it was still there to help take it. Mm-hmm. When they got on the other side, they were going to draw new tanks. Well, the battalion maintenance was still on the other side. We didn't go over there with them. Mm-hmm. We went over for some lessons, some new equipment they had, but anyway, and something on the new tanks, and then we'd go back. They built a pontoon bridge across there. Mm-hmm. Well, when they drew their new tanks, we had to bring the old tanks back. I went across the Rhine River on a pontoon bridge in a tank by myself, driving it.
Wow.
That was something else. It must have been 3/4 or maybe a mile across that river there. Mm-hmm. And the bridge went like this in a big loop because it was spring and the water was terrible flowing. Mm-hmm. It was really swift. And my tracks were running about that far under the water on these, on this pontoon bridge. Mm-hmm. And the compressor was blowing the pontoons up, was just ahead of me, blowing them up so he could stand the weight of the tanks instead of the trucks and the other jeeps and the other things going across. Mm-hmm. Most exciting thing I done. Now, I didn't have no life jacket or anything on either. I look out there and you can see the water picking up in the tracks.
So the pontoon bridge actually would go under the surface of the water.
With the weight of the vehicle. Mm-hmm. It wasn't supposed to, no. Mm-hmm.
But so you were trying to stay on the bridge with the water rushing and...
Well, you got a track you run down. Mm-hmm. You know, it's raised like this. Mm-hmm. It's very similar to the ones you use on, like, automobiles, on transport, you've seen them. Mm-hmm. And you run down that. Of course, they had to change the width of them. Mm-hmm. From a wheel vehicle, they had to move them, too, ahead of. Mm-hmm. That was exciting.
that sounds like a challenge for sure. Well, you weren't under attack at that time, though, right? I mean, there was...
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you were.
Well, they attacked the Remagen Bridge night and day. Mm-hmm. But mostly at night. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they put submarine men in the water and then floated them down the river to try to blow the bridge up. And at night, you'd see a flare coming in. And they come in, float right over the bridge, and then everything can break loose. Mm-hmm. It's like the 4th of July.
Mm-hmm. So the lights would come up, and you knew something was going to happen.
Well, it was on a parachute. You've seen them. It's like the 4th of July here. Mm-hmm. You'd see it coming in, floating in. And then pretty soon you'd get right over the bridge, and then all hell would break loose. Mm-hmm. Of course, you better get somewhere undercover. Mm-hmm. We had stationed in the railroad yard there, and they had a big underground, I don't know what it was kind of an underground room down there where they went, the railroaders. Of course, there wasn't no railroaders there. Mm-hmm. That's where we would go when they done that.
To try to get some protection.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was deep enough. We had plenty of protection.
Mm-hmm. You were telling me earlier about something about a bridge, and then there was like a cave on the other side.
That's the Remagen Bridge. Okay. That was a railroad bridge. Mm-hmm. The railroad came down, turned, and went across the bridge. Mm-hmm. Have you ever been to Canada?
Yes.
You know the bridge up there you go across? Mm-hmm. Reminds me of that exactly. On the other side, though, was a tunnel. That railroad, because there's a big bluff on the other side, a road running right close to the river, mm-hmm. But there was a big bluff up here, and the railroad tracks went back in that tunnel.
Right into a tunnel, okay.
And they were back in that tunnel. They had wired the bridge to explode it, mm-hmm. but for some reason it didn't go off. And they think probably a shell cut the wires, mm-hmm. before they could detonate it. Mm-hmm. And it was still up. But to continue bombing, and us bombing, and the name bombing it, bombed the bridge just one day, just fell down. Mm-hmm. They wasn't even doing anything then.
Just collapsed.
Just collapsed. And we had, there was two towers on each side. And we had men in those four towers on each side, guarding the bridge approaches. It, in one of those stories in the book, it tells about.
So how did they get the Germans that were in the tunnel hiding in there?
They went out the other end, I guess. Where they finally went, it was it. But up on the bluff, when you got across there, you had to turn and go up on top, which was really bad. But they had one of them railroad guns up there. I've seen them in some of the pictures. I never seen this one, but I heard it coming in. And they brought it up there to fire on the Remagen Bridge.
Okay.
That was something else. They tried to blow it up, but it just didn't make it. We got our outfit across. Of course, it fell down later, but by that time, Patton had crossed down farther downstream. If you read the story.
So where did you go after that?
Remagen? That's when we went to join Patton. We was in the First Army then. And I don't know it to be the truth, but I think Patton asked for all the cavalry outfits. I think there was 14 of them over there. I've got a thing that tells how many there was over there. And he wanted them all to run front. You know,
because he was an old cavalry man himself, you think?
Well, yes, but and he wanted to get over in a hurry. He was really, he wanted to go to Berlin, but they didn't let him do it, you know. Montgomery wanted to go there too, so Patton didn't get to go there. So. But he got his cavalry. I don't know whether he used any of the others anywhere, but I think he got them all. My old outfit, the 106, which we came from originally, we were right alongside of them for a long time. Here's one of their lost squadrons, which was with another outfit, going right alongside them. Never had time, had a chance to go and say hello or goodbye or anything. You were moving.
So you went with them to, where did you go with Patton?
We went to Austria.
Okay.
When we pulled up at Austria, the war ended and we pulled up back to Erlangen and the war was over. In Europe.
So that's...
It was May. It was May. We didn't ship out till August.
I had read that part of the 106th was responsible for saving King Leopold. Were you in part of that group?
No, now that's the old outfit. Now they got the, they wear the fort de guerre. That's that braid that goes around here. A lot of people call it the hose. You've seen it around the shoulder. That's the French fort de guerre.
Okay.
They got that for that. But we got the presidential unit citation, which actually the 32nd was actually part of the 106. That's where it came from. It was the mechanized part of the 106, which had went to Panama and come back, then joined another group. But for all practical purposes, it was still the 106. The men were there.
So what was the presidential citation, unit citation? What was that for?
Remagen Bridge.
Okay.
Breaking the across the Rhine River.
Getting your unit across and
And taking the bridge.
Taking the bridge.
See, the bridge was still standing then.
So that was for the whole unit that you were in.
I won't say anything about that.
Okay.
There's some argument about that. Was then, and probably always will be. If you read the story, and then there's another part of the story in my book where we should have some other honors, but of course, who knows? It don't do no good now. And I've never got my presidential citation yet. Because when they took the high pointers out of the outfit and attached them to infantry for quarters and rations so they could go to the South Pacific, that outfit never went through our files and awarded us our ribbons.
Okay.
But I still got it on my thing because I've got the proof. The only proof problem I have with the proof is the records. Our records burnt in St. Louis.
Mm-hmm.
You knew about that.
Yeah, I know a lot of service records were burned.
For me to go back and get it, I had to prove that I was with the 32nd Cavalry Squadron.
Mm-hmm.
It's the time they earned that.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, I was, and I know I was.
Mm-hmm.
But no records. We have a man whose dad was in the outfit. He's a lawyer from Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
He's been trying to check and find out where his boy came when he came back to the States. He's deceased now, his dad is.
Mm-hmm.
His dad never told him anything. Well, I never told anybody anything either until I read the book, Time for Trumpet.
Mm-hmm.
My daughter found out that I'd been in Battle of Bulge. She didn't know it.
Mm-hmm.
That was about 6-7 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
That's when I made that shadow box. I made another one for my other daughter,
mm-hmm.
that one.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they came about. I never said anything about it. I had this, a lot of this material, but it was folded up in that big book all
mm-hmm.
last time.
Mm-hmm. And this is the history of the cavalry book that you've got?
Well, not all the cavalry, but mm-hmm. of my part of it.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I was going to write a book, and I made a lot of notes right after I made that shadow box. But
mm-hmm.
and then they got old, and then I couldn't read them, and then I couldn't write. And so now I'm going to go through the book and talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I don't, and somebody tries to look at it and tell what it is,
mm-hmm.
they will have no idea
mm-hmm.
where it was. Did you know that was going if I hadn't told you?
No.
You wouldn't know that was Hitler there either.
Mm-hmm. Right.
See, things like that, and the shadow box itself. To look at it, mm-hmm. it's kind of pretty,
mm-hmm.
but it actually tells a story.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we could get the shadow box. Is Elif here? Do you mind going through that?
No.
Like you did with me earlier, and just point out the different things?
Up at the top, it says National Guard.
Mm-hmm.
This is the emblem for National Guard. You come over here, go look and see what's on. This is the cavalry.
Mm-hmm.
And see, that, same as you see up here.
Mm-hmm.
Cross sabers.
Right.
33rd Division. That's the Illinois National Guard in 1940.
Mm-hmm.
This is the Caribbean Defense. This is Panamanian.
Mm-hmm.
I had to make that because there was no metal. It was a patch.
Okay.
And I got no room for patches except for this one.
Mm-hmm.
Then after we come back to the States, we was in Texas, and we was in the 5th Corps.
Mm-hmm.
That's what that is. Then we went overseas, joined 1st Army.
Mm-hmm.
That's 1st Army. And in the 1st Army was the 18th Airborne Corps, which we joined and done recon work for a lot of the airborne troops.
Mm-hmm.
The latter part of the war, after we crossed the Rhine, we joined the 3rd Army, Patton's 3rd Army. And this is a patch we wear today.
Mm-hmm.
This one right here. When the outfit came back to the States and left the High Pointers over there to come back on to get discharged, they attached us to this outfit for quarters and rations, which was an infantry outfit,
mm-hmm.
89th Division. It also came up bad because when they wrote our discharges, they said we were discharged from the infantry. However, we were never in the infantry.
Mm-hmm.
It just happened that they put us there for quarters and rations until we could get a ride back home.
Ah.
That's how that happened. This is a Korean.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, this patch is the 14th Cav Group, which the 32nd and 18th Squadrons were mm-hmm. part of. This is Battle of the Bulge ribbon.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually a miniature medal. And this is a combat medal.
Mm-hmm.
Medal. There's also a ribbon here for them. This is a Korean combat. You notice the cross sabers with the tank in them? That's armored cavalry.
Okay.
Next one's 44. Can you get that 44? Mm-hmm. That's the 44th Illinois National Guard.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it was Korean.
Mm-hmm.
Then I went to school and I shipped overseas as a motor officer. I went to motor officer school in Fort Knox. By the way, I graduated with honors. I joined this outfit, which is a 70th Tank, which was a part of the 1st Cav Division.
Mm-hmm.
And I served my time, which was supposed to have been 24 to start with and then 18 months of service. Well, it came the 18th month and they didn't discharge me. Critical MOS. We had no captain. We had only had this warrant officer, which was me, as a motor officer. So they held me.
Mm-hmm. That was in Korea?
No. The first cab had pulled back when we were up in Hokkaido. Mm-hmm. You know where the Winter Olympics was in Japan about 5 or 6 years ago?
Okay.
And that's Hokkaido.
Mm-hmm.
We were up there. Mm-hmm. But the Cavalry had pulled out, were retraining or, you know, they were in reserve.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what that were. And then I finally got discharged from that outfit. These things here tell these outfits, these are my
dog tags
for the last time.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have any of my original. They were different than these. They had a lot of more information on them.
Mm-hmm.
These are my campaigns. This is the presidential unit citation. This is a ruptured duck. This is the thing they sewed on us when we got discharged after World War II to show that you was a discharged serviceman.
Mm-hmm.
Ruptured duck, we call them.
Okay.
This is my highest grade. This is warrant officer.
Mm-hmm.
This is my name, my serial number. This is the thing part I wear on my hat and on my collar. This is my highest grade as a enlisted man.
Mm-hmm.
Master Sergeant. This is my name, my serial number. This is branch.
Mm-hmm.
See the cross sabers?
Mm-hmm.
Down here is the most important part. Down here is the four ships I went overseas on. The first one is the, what's the name of it? I have to read it. Algonquin.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's the one that was a converted cattle boat. Because in 1940, they didn't know anything about transport. You know, we hadn't sent them in overseas yet.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we had, but not during after war started.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it was. They didn't have a galley on it, or not for us anyway. We ate on deck.
Mm-hmm.
And we ate in shifts. Now, try to carry a peach on a flat piece of glass with the round part down on a rolling ship walking down the deck. That was going to be the name of my book. You get it? The peach was going to be the name.
The peach, okay.
Because there was no way you was going to eat that peach because it was going to go overboard.
Mm-hmm. Where did you sleep on that board that ship?
We slept, I think it was four bunks high. They built them down in the bilge, or down in the, yeah, down there too,
mm-hmm.
in the ship, and that's where we slept.
Mm-hmm.
We tried to sleep in shifts. See, when we took off, it was in January, and we was in wools, which is winter uniforms. Of course, a couple of days out of New Orleans, it started turning warm because we was headed for Panama. And it got warmer and warmer, and the more warmer it got, the more ships stunk. And the more we wanted to get out on deck, but everybody couldn't get out on deck at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
No nobody with us, no other transport, just that ship,
mm-hmm.
all by itself. And we ended up, Panama went through the locks from mm-hmm. Cologne to the southeast to Panama.
Mm-hmm.
How is that possible? Remember, we're going from the Caribbean to the Pacific, but we're going southeast.
Right, it's a strange place.
That's because there's a gooseneck in the isthmus. Mm-hmm. That's how that comes about.
Right.
While we was there, we went out and seen old Panama. You know, Morgan the pirate burned it and took all the people from Panama and marched them across the canal. See, there was no road across the canal, only the railroad. I don't know where you knew that. Mm-hmm. While we was there, they did complete a road across. You couldn't go from Cologne to Panama. You had to go on a train. Mm-hmm. But while we was there, they did get it built. But Morgan took the people. They gathered rocks and dropped them, gathered an insect and dropped them, and made a road from one side of the isthmus to the other.
Mm-hmm. While you were there, that was...
Oh, no, Morgan the pirate. It was long before we was ever there.
Oh, okay.
He pillaged Panama.
Okay.
They called it Old Panama. They also had an alligator farm out there. And they made pocketbooks, jodhpurs. I had a pair of jodhpurs made out there. It lasted forever. Mm-hmm. Not the bottoms, but the tops, belts. Mm-hmm. It was an alligator farm. Mm-hmm.
That was, yeah. And you were so young, too, when you were there and doing all that. It's just amazing to me.
Well, I wasn't the only one was young. There was many of them. We had no idea that the guard was going to be called out. Mm-hmm. Think about these students at the U of I here who were going to school, and they thought they'd beat the draft, so they joined the guard. Mm-hmm. Well, the 106th was one of the first outfits that was called into service before they even had the draft.
So they were shipped out with you all?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. We had several of them in the outfit. Stan Porsby, I shouldn't mention any names, but Stan Porsby and one of them. Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to see if there was anything else that I wanted to ask you about. I guess I'm a little interested in what happened after you did finally get discharged from, you know, the European front, and you came back to the States. Did you, stayed in the Guard?
No.
No, okay.
I got out in 45, August 45, and I went to work at a bakery here. Mm-hmm. However, at that time they had something like a 3 months, you could draw pay for 3 months before you had to go to work. Mm-hmm. Well, I didn't draw that, so I wanted to go to work and make some money so mm-hmm. to spend. So I went to work at a bakery. In fact, it was right down here on Main Street in Urbana, Purity. Mm-hmm. I worked there about 6 or 7 months. My dad worked for Sullivan Chevrolet, mm-hmm. as shop foreman. And I got burnt real bad, and the insurance company wouldn't do anything about it, so I quit. Mm-hmm. And I went to work for Sullivan Chevrolet, and that's where I was. Mm-hmm. And while I was there, one of my buddies I was in the service with worked there. Mm-hmm. Well, his brother took when the 106th was reformed in 40, it must have been early 47, his brother got one of the troops, Troop C. Mm-hmm. By the way, his dad was also in the outfit. We had three fathers with sons, and they were in the outfit at one time.
Wow.
One of them had two boys in the service. Mm-hmm. We also had 22 brothers.
Oh, my.
Where was that?
You were telling me
He came to me and said, my brother's going to get C Troop, and he needs a motor sergeant. Of course, that's what I was in. Mm-hmm. I said, I don't want to get back in. Look what happened to me the last time. Oh, he said, come on, they'll never call the guard again. I said, I don't want to. Well, times were still tough then. Mm-hmm. And extra money helped. So finally I said, I'll go in for one year. So they swore me in as a staff sergeant. They had to do that because they couldn't promote me because I wasn't in service, you know. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So they had to do it that way. And at the end of the year, well, they talked me into staying in. And then I went to tech, and then I went to master. And then there's only one other step you have to go to officer after that. So I started a Series 10, which is a program where you, something like ROTC.
Okay.
Only you take it home.
Mm-hmm.
I was taking that course to be a second lieutenant when they offered me the warrant officer in battalion maintenance, which was my line.
Mm-hmm.
Before that, they had offered me in one in personnel. I wouldn't take that. I didn't want to stay inside. I couldn't operate a typewriter anyway. But anyway, it was right down my line, so that's how I got back in the outfit. Then the 106th Cavalry was changed to 106th Tank Battalion.
Mm-hmm.
Then in 1952, they activate the 106th Tank Battalion.
Mm-hmm.
Federal duty.
Okay.
And there I was. Now, they wanted to make me a warrant officer, but I hadn't graduated from high school.
Mm-hmm.
So to make a warrant, I came over to the University of Illinois and wrote the entry exam, me and another guy. We passed it.
Mm-hmm.
Because they had to do it immediately. And that's how we got our high school diplomas.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It was part of that program, but we didn't have no time to write the one that, you know, that most people write.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what they done. They sent me and him over here on South Wright Street. I think it was a couple of days, maybe three.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't have to take history. Math was a tough one.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah, how much of the ship displacement, you know, and those kind of things. But him and I both passed it,
mm-hmm.
and we both got our high school diploma, and they made me a warrant officer, and that's the story.
Mm-hmm. So then you were in Korea, and what did you do for a living then, other than that, when you got back?
I was a mechanic, and mm-hmm. then I was a service writer, then I done warranty work, and I met my first wife,
mm-hmm.
and then I took a service manager's job at Gibson City. That's where you had to do it. You had to, you know, go up the ladder. And then a buddy of mine wanted me to take one in Danville, so I went to Danville and took it. And then a buddy of mine I went to school with bought a dealership in Decatur.
Mm-hmm.
And he called me and wanted to know if I moved to Decatur. And so I did, and that was in 67.
Mm-hmm.
But Urbana's my hometown.
Mm-hmm. So you kind of stayed in the mechanics sort of field, or, you know.
That was my field. That's mm-hmm. that's what I done.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The big problem I have now, at the time, they made me a warrant. They didn't tell me that you don't get discharged.
You don't get discharged.
See, you got a warrant. Congress gives you a warrant.
Mm-hmm.
You're a specialist in some field, where it be personnel. Armor was mine, tanks.
Mm-hmm.
That was my specialty. So you say, well, you're going to serve this many months, like they call them cats, and maybe 8 months, maybe 24 months, in ever so many periods. And then when they're done with you, you just revert back to National Guard and just set their inactive reserve.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way it's been since 53.
So you were forever in active reserves, pretty much.
Yeah. Battle commissions are the same way.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't revert a battlefield commission back to what?
Hmm.
There isn't any. My buddy in Arizona, I wish it was next month, because he's going to be back.
Mm-hmm.
I wish he could have came over here with me.
Mm-hmm.
Because him and I served 5 years together. Didn't see him every day, but
mm-hmm.
of course I didn't see my other buddies I was in tent in Louisiana with every day either.
Mm-hmm.
But we only lost one out of that bunch, and that's amazing.
It is amazing.
And then you seen three of them in Chicago the day we got discharged in 45.
Mm-hmm.
And an amazing thing happened. We was walking down the street and heard a whistle. And a cab pulled up, and one of the gentleman out of the 106th was driving that cab. He took us everywhere we wanted to go in Chicago. Mm-hmm. He knew them all, and we had our leave pay. See, we never had any leaves in all them years, and we had our discharge pay and all that. And we left it in a tavern and went out and done the town.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where that picture comes from. And
the three of you with the cigars and...
Yeah, you know, the surprising thing when I took my steel helmet off, I had curly hair.
That surprised you.
I did. I didn't even know I had any hair. That's a terrible thing to have to wear every day.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was such a long time you were in when you started in 1940 as a 17-year-old, and really you had very little leave from then until the war was over.
Like I say, but being a National Guard outfit helps. All those guys are from your hometown.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of them I could throw a rock to their house. In fact, that one boy lives the second door from me,
mm-hmm.
Wilson. I said I would not tell him their names.
But that was a good thing that you were all together and
that long time.
Well, did that make it easier sometimes when you were in the combat situation to kind of knew what you were fighting
sure.
for?
Sure, you lay it off on your buddy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it makes you want to really do it right because you've got an outfit that's got a history mm-hmm. of service. And that makes your esprit de corps.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing was special about our outfit, we wore our hats on the left side.
Mm-hmm.
The Army doesn't wear their hats on the left side, they wear them on the right side.
Mm-hmm.
But we did. We have permission to wear them that way.
Mm-hmm.
The hats were special made. Our overseas caps, they were real tall. You'll notice in some of the pictures, they're not like some of the others.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that we had 22 brothers in the outfit.
Mm-hmm.
My brother was NC. The fella in Arizona says I missed one. Well, of course it's possible. You know, I was counting them from my memory. He said I missed one in Springfield. Now his dad and his brother and him were all in the 106.
Oh, wow. It's a real, all the family group in a way.
Well, that points to the reason we had a lot of esprit de corps.
Mm-hmm.
When we go to town, we had to be inspected. Everybody else looked up to us because we wore boots and breeches,
mm-hmm.
like officers. See, officers wore boots and breeches in those days, if you ever seen the pinks and greens.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had them laces. I didn't tell you what happened to them in the end. In the end, we had what's called three buckle boots. But we didn't get those, that's the latter part of 41, I think. Anyway, they had three buckles up here and they just pulled it over. And the only part you had the lace was down here.
Mm-hmm. Well, that sounds a lot better.
Oh, it was. But I had a pair of, while I was in Panama, I had a pair of Jodhpurs, alligator, like I said.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how many soles I wore out, but you know where the tops of them out.
Mm-hmm. You haven't said much about your commanding officers and communication between the troops and the officers. How did you feel about that while you were in the European front and in the Battle of the Bulge?
They were from my outfit.
Mm-hmm.
Most of them. They came from here too.
Mm-hmm.
Our commander, after the other one went a little berserk, he took over. He was from Chicago, but he had been in the 106 for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful officer. His mm-hmm. name was Cracky.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you his name because you'll see it in the paper.
Mm-hmm.
But he took over. I didn't know why they hadn't made him CO long before that. He was a wonderful officer. The second time, Colonel O'Lean was my commander, and he was from Springfield. Now, my original company commander was from the East End of Urbana, and he became a general of the 106th Cavalry Group
mm-hmm.
after they picked up another squadron.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I got back in the second time, you'll see his name down at the bottom of my discharge. Mm-hmm.
So you had a lot of trust and a lot of feeling of understanding and confidence in these guys.
You knew the men. Mm-hmm. You knew where they came from, and you knew if you was in trouble, he was there.
Mm-hmm. And that made a big difference, even though when you were there in the Battle of the Bulge and you didn't quite know what was going on, everything seemed kind of chaotic, but...
Well, it was. Mm-hmm. We were, I suppose, fairly lucky in the fact that we were on wheels, you know, and we could move away. In fact, they were moving back. That was the day I was going up there. Mm-hmm. In the wrecker. Mm-hmm. You know, I meant to tell you the rest of the story of a man in the half track in the railroad yards at St. Biff. Pappy, I'm not going to tell you his last name. Mm-hmm. He was a master sergeant. Anyway, I told you I didn't remember much after we pulled up out. It was terrible. But anyway, when we formed in Luxembourg, the old-timers and the high-pointers, to be shipped back to Camp Lucky Strike for shipment to the United States, mm-hmm. Pappy was in the truck in front of me. That's the first time I'd seen him since that day. Mm-hmm. He was sitting in the back of the truck, and they was transporting us back to Camp Lucky Strike, which is, what was the name of the port there in France where he's going out of? Anyway, he went to sleep. And then they had the guard across the back, had a strap went across there, keep him falling out. And they was going down the street and hit a big bump, and he was asleep and he fell out of the back of the truck. After he went through all that, he rolled down, must have been a half a block, and bleeding all over, and got up and got right back in the truck and sat down. But think of this man.
Yes, his mind was in an interesting place, but he was the one that was cooking his meal.
That's
while
the guy.
His tank was broken down.
Well, they put it on the manifold because it's hot, mm-hmm. and you take them sea rations, you know, and you know how they was. Every tire in Europe had round circles all over them. That was from the sea cans they threw away, mm-hmm. the lids and the bottom. Mm-hmm. You weren't supposed to do that, but they did. Who was going to tell them not to? But anyway, that's what they was doing. They was cooking their dinner. Mm-hmm. Get on there, Pappy, we're going to leave. We're going to take you out of here. And we did. And again, I don't know what happened to the wrecker. Mm-hmm. And nor do I know what happened to the half track. Until the day that Pappy, I seen him on transport. This would have been in probably June. And that was way back in, that was way back in December. Mm-hmm. That I'd last seen him.
So did you get a chance to talk to him then, or?
Never got to talk to him.
Okay.
He was in a different part of the camp than I was in. I don't know why I didn't go and talk to him, but I didn't wonder about it till people started asking me about it 4 or 5 years ago.
Mm-hmm. So there was a long time after the war that you didn't really want to talk about all these things that went on.
Yeah. But the people, when you went to reunions, there was no use them talking about it because they already was there. And they never said anything, you know. I think most of them felt that we were bragging or doing something like that, but mm-hmm. of course the brave ones are still there.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you were all brave.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can't say as I ever knew anybody from our outfit that ever run, except the commander, that one they sent us, but mm-hmm. that wasn't his fault. That happens to a lot of them. Mm-hmm. In fact, I don't think I know anybody that it happened to. I'm sure there was. Mm-hmm. But again, when you're in situations like that, there's you and that other guy. Mm-hmm. And that's your circle. That's about it. Mm-hmm. You have no correspondence with anybody else. Mm-hmm. Like me and that Pennsylvania in that foxhole. And it wasn't funny. Mm-hmm. Well, it was, I mean, that he would say that at that time. But, mm-hmm. I'm trying to think if I ever saw him again. You know, and I never went to Pennsylvania to see those guys. They evidently broke the Pennsylvania 104th Cav, which was similar to the 106th, mm-hmm. only from Pennsylvania. And evidently broke them up, and they sent those men to us in Panama. We got quite a few of them, and was one of the reasons why there wasn't much rank advancement in the 32nd, mm-hmm. because most of those guys had quite a bit of rank. Mm-hmm. So there was no promotion. There ain't no openings, you don't get promoted.
Right.
But we didn't feel bad about it. Mm-hmm. It was in a town we took, and there was a castle there. And the castle had a safe in it. Well, they tried to get it open, but this castle had a moat around it. It was also an ammo dump for the Germans. Well, they had a big pile of mashed potato mashers. That was a German hand grenade. That's what we called them. Had a long handle on with them. They had a pile of them there. Well, we were afraid it was booby traps, but we wanted to get in that safe to see what was in it. That was about the only thing that was left in the castle. Mm-hmm. A big castle. It must have been along the Rhine when we was doing that. It's hard for me to remember exactly where them things were. Mm-hmm. But anyway, we get it out there and we lay the door over on this pile of German hand grenades, and then we take one of our own and set it in the pile and pull the pin. And we blew that thing 30 feet in the air, and it came back down. We knocked the door off of it all right. But there was a cigar box in there and had some of those war German coins in it. That was all was in that safe after we went to all that trouble.
All that trouble. But the castle was cleared out. There was nothing else in there.
Well, we had two sets of heaven in China we buried in somewhere along that area. Mm-hmm. We found upstairs in a tavern. And we buried them. They said, we'll come back at the war and get them. Of course, I can't even remember now where it was. Mm-hmm. That was also a band of guys. That one you seen stand with in Belgium, he was the other one. Mm-hmm. Two sets. Beautiful stuff. Mm-hmm. We never went back that way. We wasn't really stealing, you know, mm-hmm. because we didn't ask to be there in the first place. Mm-hmm. That's the way we got to look at it. Like the time we got a little too much to drink on champagne and went chicken hunting with our Thompsons. Oh, it's a fact.
You want to tell me that story?
No, I'm afraid I don't want to tell you that.
Okay.
I mean, you had to think of how the men felt at that time. Mm-hmm. You know, you're outside all the time. You're just kind of tired all the time. Like you're kind of walking in a dream. It's what it's something like. You know, mm-hmm. things don't really matter to you. Mm-hmm. Food and a warm place to stay. About it. We didn't being the cavalry. We didn't have too much trouble that way. If there was any building standing, we would get in it. We also sometimes would hook our generator on. We had a big welder, enormous welder. We'd hook our generator on the outside of the building, turn the lights on inside. Mm-hmm. Of course, when it came time to turn them off, we never got up. We shot them out with our rifles. Mm-hmm. When it was time to go to bed, let the generator run. We'd done that too. You got any more questions?
Well, let me look. You have any more stories?
Oh, lots of stories.
Lots of stories.
We moved into this valley, and that was after we had crossed the Rhine. And it went downhill and gradually widened out down the bottom. And down the bottom of the hill on the left side was a bunch of gliders. Airplane gliders, mm-hmm. where they talk glide, and evidently they had cut wood there for some reason. There was a big pile of wood there, And they also, it must have been a German quartermaster outlet or something that had some, we call them Czechoslovakian motorcycles in the crates. Well, you know how Americans are. They didn't have no batteries on them, and they were still in the crates. Handlebars wasn't on. Of course, we fixed that up, we being Americans. But the wood pile was the thing. They got to playing in that wood pile, you know, but with a little relaxing. And sure enough, the Germans had hid champagne in the bottom of it. That's how this whole thing started.
So they hid champagne in the wood pile.
French champagne, the best.
Oh.
The wood pile maybe was 10, 12 feet tall. And there was a lot down in there. But, of course, you couldn't see it. That's where they hid it. Of course, we found it. In the meantime, well, of course, we was drinking that. In the meantime, we were running the gliders. We'd haul, well, it must have been a couple miles up the valley, and it was going uphill, and like I say, it widened down the bottom. And that's where they taught the Germans to fly gliders.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, some of the boys from Springfield and some from Urbana, too, was out there flying the gliders. When we left, none of those gliders would fly anymore.
You saw to that.
Anyway, this is where the chicken thing came in. We was drinking that champagne, kind of celebrating, and the guy said, you know, I seen a bunch of chickens in a farmyard down the road. And so the guy said, well, let's go get them. We'll have a chicken fry. He said, well, let's put some water on first. So we took a 55-gallon drum filled with water and put it on the fire to heat, you know, so we could pick the chickens.
Mm-hmm.
We get, four of us get in the Jeep, we go down the road half a mile or so and pull up this Sherman house. The farmer comes out, he's waving his hands. Says, you can have my eggs, but don't take my chickens. Of course, you know, by that time, anything he said wasn't what stopped us.
Mm-hmm.
So we opened up with them Thompsons and shot all these chickens. I ain't too proud of that. Yeah, that's why I didn't tell the story. But anyway, we took them back there and threw them in the hot water to pick them. They wasn't worth picking. The Thompson's a 45, and he goes in and makes a hole about the size of your finger. When it comes out the other side, it just tears all the meat out of it.
Oh.
But that's also the time I almost shot myself.
How did that happen?
Well, we took them motorcycles and put the handlebars on them, and then we took one of our batteries, 12, I think they used 12 volt. Anyway, ours was big ones. And we put them on the stand that was on the back of them and rode them.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we'd ride down the hill, and then the hill made a turn, but instead of turning, it went up between two fence posts and went up a hill. We'd come down that hill, and then instead of turning, we'd run up that hill between them fence posts to see how far we could go up that hill.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I came down too and went up through that hill, started up the hill and went through them fence posts. There was a little bump there. And I hit that bump. Well, my Thompson slid over on my shoulder, and of course we carried around in the chamber.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it hit the bolt, that fence post did, and of course it set the shell off that was in the chamber and went right up behind my ear. Well, I thought it was a sniper. So I threw the motorcycle on the side, and I looked all around. I didn't see nobody, but then I seen the smoke coming out the barrel of my own gun. That happened at the same time. That was after we crossed the Rhine. That was down in Rhineland somewhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, so that was after the worst of the battles were over anyway. And
well, it points out how you get.
Mm-hmm. Well, you were only about 20 years old at the time.
Yeah, I was 23 when I got out.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I wouldn't normally do that. Nor would them other fellows, probably.
Mm-hmm.
But they'd taken about all they could take.
Mm-hmm.
We had a lot of problem with our prisoners. None of them admitted they were Nazis. You'll see that in those newsletters. Mm-hmm. It can't be true.
So you took prisoners. Your
Lots
group
of
did.
Mm-hmm.
And where would
then
you...
Then after the... not the Bastogne. Where they massacred over that outfit. They didn't take no prisoners after that. Mm-hmm. I can't think of the name of the town now. Anyway, we didn't take any after that. Mm-hmm. Well, they made us, then they finally had to make them take again. Take them.
Mm-hmm. So, but none of them would admit that they were Nazis, the prisoners that you took.
No, and you, this is a officer talking about it, about him talking to people. They also didn't know them slave camps were going on, or they were killing those people. And, mm-hmm. You know, they were surprised when they took the townspeople and marched them out there to see those places. Mm-hmm. It ain't possible. The smell alone would tell you there's something wrong. Mm-hmm. It's terrible to release your own men and not recognize them.
So did you came up with, against some of the POW camps, you released them?
Thank God I wasn't up there then. I was in the outfit, but I didn't happen to be up there at that time, and I'm glad I wasn't. Mm-hmm. One of the boys from Sadorus had a brother. There was a pair of brothers. Mm-hmm. One of them was in the 106th, and the other one, he was in the they were both in the medics. And one of them wanted to be a tank driver. So when we come back to the States in 43, he said he wanted to be a tank driver. You'll see his picture in there. Prisoner of war. So he did. And they had a new tank, a heavier tank than we had, and it was part of our outfit, and they went over early, which they do sometimes. Anyway, when they landed and started out from Omaha, they would run low on fuel. Well, the Red Ball Express was supposed to bring fuel to them. When they got there, they had sold it on the black market. So the Germans captured that whole bunch of tanks and the men. Mm-hmm. They took them to a prisoner of war camp, and Goebbels come around. And this guy's name was of German descent. Mm-hmm. And he said, what's your name? Of course, you give your name, rank, and serial number. And he said, well, just a minute. I got a guy I want you to meet. He took him and went over in another compound there, and there was his brother.
Wow. The same place.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And they lived with Stewart? I think so. He has passed away lately.
Mm-hmm. So they both made it out. Okay.
Both of them made out. Mm-hmm. Made it out. But they were in different outfits. Mm-hmm. And ended up in the same prisoner of war camp. Mm-hmm. Now, the one was captured early on. They had just landed in Omaha. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And the other one was captured when our outfit was. So that was about six, no, not six, yeah, about 6 months mm-hmm. after we landed. Mm-hmm. But originally, or the other was also a medic. Mm-hmm. They were both medics. Mm-hmm. But the one, he wanted to be a tank driver. Yeah, no, and I'd went off to school and lost track of him, and I didn't know he'd done that until mm-hmm. after the war was over. I didn't see him, but you see so many guys, I didn't know where he went. When we come back to the States in 43, we lost quite a few people through OCS and cadres. You know, they go to another outfit to form an outfit. It wasn't real bad. In some outfits, it was real bad. It decimated them. Mm-hmm. There wasn't no line of command. They had taken everything out of them. Mm-hmm. But being that we had been overseas, and we hadn't run into a lot of that, we had a lot of them go to OCS. Mm-hmm. We had a guy from Urbana, played on the basketball team, lived in the East End of Urbana, and went to OCS, and where do you think they sent him? They sent him to Panama, and he ended up in the a squadron of the 106.
Okay.
And he knew everybody in it. He went to school with them. Another good part about being National Guard.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then there's a part of your family.
Mm-hmm.
Your families know each other in a lot of the cases.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a mail wasn't too lively. Packages was, we never got. Never seen a show. What do you call the shows?
The USO?
Yeah. Never saw one.
Really?
Well, we was, they didn't have shows.
Mm.
The only ones I saw up there was the Donut Givers.
Okay.
Now you know what I'm talking about.
Well, I think I do.
The Red Cross.
Mm-hmm.
And the only ones I've seen up there.
Mm-hmm. But your family back home, your families were able to kind of keep in touch with each other and sort of try to keep in touch with what was happening with you all.
Well, you seen the reunion thing they had for us. So they formed that before we ever come back. The funny thing about it, I'm the eldest of seven children. When I left and when I came back on the furlough the second time, my family had moved, but they didn't tell me. There were so many children that I said they never even missed me. They thought I'd been out playing somewhere. But I went up the old house I lived on, East High Street, knocked on the door, and a strange woman come to the door. I didn't know who it was. It wasn't a part of my family.
Uh-huh.
So I said, do you know where the people moved to or used to live? No, don't know. Well, the people two doors down still lived there when I lived there. And they told me where they lived. They moved over on Main Street in Urbana. But can you imagine that?
Of course, this is,
it wasn't quite that bad, but that's the way we always tell the story.
This is when you finally got some furlough after not having any for a really long time, right?
That's right. We only had 10 days then.
Mm-hmm.
That's 14 days and 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
And which, when I think about these today, in 90 days they want a furlough.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not too sure that's the right way to go.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I didn't like the Korean way they done it in Korea. They left the same outfits over there too long.
Mm-hmm.
The 1st Division, 1st Cav Division, 2nd Division, the 3rd Division, 4th Division, 5th Division, 25th, 26th. They were over for years.
Mm-hmm.
They would rotate men into it, but I never thought that was the way to do it. For Esprit de Corps, I thought at least troop size, which would a troop could run. Well, I don't know how many men, according to what kind of troop it was, but you know, when they train together, they should go overseas together.
Mm-hmm.
Again, the National Guard had the advantage.
Mm-hmm.
They already knew each other in most cases.
Mm-hmm. So how long were you actually in Europe then, if you went over?
We went over in August. I think it was August.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then we didn't leave till August. However, the war ended in May.
Okay.
But they took, remember I said they took us out of the outfit for transport back
right.
to the States. We were supposed to march down Fifth Avenue on VJ Day. Mm-hmm. This is a fact.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it never happened that way.
Mm-hmm.
Because we was on our way back, but when we got back, gave us new uniforms and sent us to Fort Sheridan.
Mm-hmm.
And there was the outfit again. Lots of them.
But you did finally have that day in Chicago with your buddies, and you
sure.
ran into.
Sure. I wouldn't trade it for anything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we were kind of, we were young men, but you know, we'd been through a lot together, and we weren't taking any hurry to get home.
Mm-hmm.
You've been out there 5 years already.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a little party.
Mm-hmm.
And we really didn't, the people wouldn't take our money. They hadn't seen anybody downtown. We were downtown in Chicago. The bandbox was down on the lower level. I can't tell you exactly where it was at. It was downtown. And this guy that drove the taxi, I told you it was from the 106th,
right,
said that's the place to go. And sure enough, we ran into these three girls, and they were from Gary. And they were in town for a party, and so we had a party. We went to, by the way, we did go to the amusement park, too, with them same ones. But we had a party. Three days, I think it was. Right before I got on the train, went home.
And the people of Chicago were happy to, they treated you right?
I'll have to say the people in New York was just as good. I wouldn't live there, but when me and that taxi driver came back from delivering them two Jeeps down to Brooklyn Navy Yards, he knew every tavern between there and northern New York, and he stopped at every one. And everything was on the house. It was, I felt sorry for my buddies. No, I didn't even take them. They were back there, they were quarantined, they couldn't get out. But the part was when we went down to Brooklyn Navy Yards. He'd go through the stop sign on the yellow. I'd have to go through on the red, because if I lost him, I never would find him.
So you just stayed right with him the
whole
time.
I was driving the Jeep. He was driving the truck with the Jeep in the back, the other one, up in the... I guess they didn't have another driver to take it down there, but he done that in his spare time. He drove an army truck, civilian army. It was a civilian, or an army truck, but he was a civilian. I wonder what happened to him. Who knows? We landed, when we came back, we went to Camp Kimmler, New Jersey. And they, like I said, they gave us new uniforms and put us on a train. Of course, a day coach. We never went on Pullman. Only time I went to Pullman was when I was an officer and went to California. And we went to see Sheridan and the discharge. The last time I got out of active duty, I got discharged in Colorado, Camp Carson. That's now the Air Force training. That's, what's that town there?
Is it Boulder?
No.
No, Colorado Springs?
Yeah. That's, you can see Pike's Peak from there. That's the desert, that's what I said. When I seen it, being from Illinois, it looks like a desert. California does too in the summer, if you've ever been to California. Rains all winter, and then in the summer it dries up. And I lived in Santa Barbara, and we couldn't even water the yard. Well, it was no good. They didn't have no grass in their yards out there. See, we'd come in on weekends from camp. It's about 60 miles out to camp. Nearest town where you could get any place to live. That's Vandenberg now.
Okay.
It's where they fire the rockets out of.
But when you came back to New Jersey and they put you on the day coach on the train and...
Way of mine.
And you came back to Chicago then, and that's when you got to Chicago. And
funny thing about when they shipped us from Texas, though, to New York, we went through Tolona. We couldn't figure why the MPs gathered at all the doors. It was at night on the train. That was the reason.
They didn't want you getting off the train.
We were all from Central, well, the nucleus, that was from Central Illinois. They didn't want us getting off the train. I didn't tell you how we celebrated New Year's Eve, though, that year that we went in. We got on the train, New Year's Eve, and of course we was going south to New Orleans. Well, the train stopped in Memphis. Well, we were sitting there and we was talking about it. It was New Year's Eve and we wasn't doing anything. We looked across the street and there was a liquor store. So I jumped off the train, run over and got a fifth of whiskey, which None of us ever drank before. I never drank beer either. And got a fifth of whiskey, and that was our New Year's party.
Mm-hmm. This is when you went down to Louisiana, right?
That's right.
First
that was,
called up.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That was in, well, it was December, the last day of December, mm-hmm. New Year's Eve.
Mm-hmm.
We was home Christmas that year.
Mm-hmm.
We wasn't home any other time at Christmas.
Well, I'm thinking we might wrap up unless we have, you have anything you'd like to say about, you know, what you think people ought to remember. I mean, part of this project and having people tell their memories and stories is so that our children and our grandchildren will have a record of what actually went on.
I got one more story, and this is the reason why they should tell it in Urbana.
Okay.
After we became a tank battalion, we had a 4th of July parade. And we just became a tank battalion, and we had very few tank drivers. However, I taught tank driving, and so I drove the lead tank.
Mm-hmm.
When you're driving a tank, when you're going to park it or anything like that, you have a man down, and he directs you. How, go, you know, like this.
Mm-hmm.
Directs you how to drive it, because you can't see the right side of it at all. Anyway, we pulled up, come down University Avenue from the Armory, went under the interurban wires that's still up there, mm-hmm. was then.
Mm-hmm.
And our antennas, you should have seen the fireworks they put out when they hit them interurban wires.
Uh-huh.
And we turned on Lincoln and pulled up in front of Lincoln School right over here.
Uh-huh.
Well, my man was down guiding me, the assistant driver. He said, pull it, and I pulled it. And then he said, pull it again, and I did. When I did, I'd been sitting on the curbing. And when I pulled it back straight ahead, it took a row of the curbing as long as that tank, and just turned it like that.
Uh-huh.
That wasn't the worst thing that happened.
Okay.
When the parade started, we pulled out on Main Street. You know, was going toward downtown Urbana.
Mm-hmm.
We come down there, and you know the railroad and urban tracks and used to run down the main street in Urbana.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they blacktopped them to cover them up. Well, of course, it was in the summer, 4th of July, and we're bringing these tanks down that street, and every time we made a turn, we pulled that blacktop they'd put in them to cover them railroad tracks. Well, we got down to Vine Street, which goes under the subway and then goes out to Five Points.
Uh-huh.
We took all that out there. Then tanks come down and took it.
That was the end of the blacktop.
That was the end of our parade. We never parade again in Urbana. That's a fact.
Uh-huh.
I almost forgot I'd done that. They still bring that up once in a while.
That the reason why they don't have tanks going to the parades anymore.
Yeah, you know, it was like my brother. I was teaching him to drive when he got in. And he was coming down a hill, and there was a tank stalled at the bottom in a little stream there. I said, put on the brakes. I was up in the turret, and he's down in the driver's part. He said, how do you stop this thing? You know, he's going downhill, of course. I said, the same way you steer it. Pull on them. He got to stop me. He still tells that story.
Oh.
And the horses got away too in Urbana one time.
From where they were stabled out at the Armory?
We had quite a bit of riding room out and back. I don't know how many acres they got, and then they bought on the other side behind the houses out there at Sawndown east of there. They bought all that back in there when they got the tanks.
Mm-hmm.
And built buildings to put the tanks in. Now, the horses stayed up in the armory out there, stayed upstairs. The wheel vehicles were down underneath the armory, believe it or not, because that armory was made for horses.
Mm-hmm.
They had to grab a floor. When we came back the second time, they put a floor in. Urbana High School played their basketball games till they built their new junior high school there.
Okay.
I don't know if you knew that or not.
No, I didn't. I'm not from here, actually.
Well, that's what they did. It's in the Urbana. They wrote a book,
mm-hmm.
about Urbana. Mm-hmm. Said, this is Urbana High School gym. I said, that's the armory. It recognized I marched many a mile. I rode horse inside.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, they used to have horse shows in there.
Mm-hmm.
See, headquarters prior to that had horses. When we got our horses, headquarters was no longer, they didn't have horses anymore.
Mm-hmm. So how did the horses get out?
Somebody left the gate open. The gates to the corral swung. They had the armory had a road run around, a two-lane road.
Mm-hmm.
When the gates, you open the gates from the armory to the corral, they swung up against the building and closed it off, and the horses went from the building out to corral.
Mm-hmm.
They left one of the gates open. The horses got out in the north. East part of Urbana there.
Running around town.
Of course, they got loose in Wisconsin, too. Well, I told you about that. They run off the picket line, but
mm-hmm.
we finally found them. But the worst part about it was, no matter how tired you was, that horse always came first.
Mm-hmm.
It's the only way you got around. You hate to hear the guy say, trot, ho. Oh, you walk, you can't walk no more, and then you ride, you can't ride no more. Then what do?
You take care of the horse.
Well, and some of these men were leading pack horses. That was another story that happened. And man in my platoon, one of the ammo pack horses, he was leading, and we was cross country and somewhere up in Wisconsin. Well, there was a little stream there, and we jumped the stream, and it went up a little hill, or about 6 foot tall, so we was on the run. Well, his horse jumped. Well, what had happened, he got tired of leading that horse, holding that rein, so he tied it around his wrist, the rein
mm-hmm.
of a pack horse.
Mm-hmm.
Well, his horse jumped the stream, but the pack horse didn't. I wonder he didn't tear his arm out of the socket.
Oh, gosh.
His mother ran on a rooming home on West Pennsylvania.
Mm-hmm.
And that guy in that other outfit, the 18th, roomed there and knew that guy in the 106th.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there were three brothers, and their mother run a boarding house over mm-hmm. here on, I think it was one of them streets anyway.
Mm-hmm. So it really gave you a feeling of loyalty for the guys that were with you. That was, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'd do everything but get a tattoo for them. This year at the reunion, Larry asked me if I'd come again. Because
mm-hmm.
I guess I got a little better memory, most of them. And said he got a package for me. Well, so I came, and I was sitting out there talking. I had a lot of this equipment with me. Of course, they hadn't seen it, a lot of them. You know, there's a lot of stuff there, but they was looking at that. Pretty soon, a guy walks in and walks up to me and says, you know me? I hadn't seen this guy since 42.
Mm-hmm. And he remembered you.
I remembered him.
Mm-hmm.
He had a brother. His brother is still in Louisiana and works for the power company down there. I run around with his brother more than I did him,
mm-hmm.
but I knew who he was. How long was that ago? A long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's what we're talking about. You don't forget.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, that's the regular Army's that way, but not nothing like National Guard, I don't think.
Mm-hmm.
I served in both ways.
Mm-hmm.
See, the 1st Cav was, the 14th Cav was also a regular Army outfit.
Mm-hmm.
They're still in.
Mm-hmm. Well, I really appreciate you doing this, telling this.
It's all right.
Your experiences, and even more than that, you know, serving your country and doing what you did.
Well, maybe it helps with some other people.
Mm-hmm.
I'm afraid they're giving the country away. Mm-hmm. Global's not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
If you get right down and look at it, it ain't going to work. Those people don't like us, are never going to like us, and they resent us.
Mm-hmm.
That's the big thing. And the more money you see they get, the more they don't like you. mm-hmm. because they're dependent on us. Mm-hmm. They don't like that. Mm-hmm. And I tell some of those people who buy this foreign stuff, I'm not going to go do it again for them, and I wouldn't. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't. If this lady gets in, I sure ain't going to. Mm-hmm. Now you know who I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of people, thankfully for us, that still join the National Guard and still serve their country. I mean,
we'd be in bad shape in Iraq if it wasn't for the National Guard.
Right.
That's who's there.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
We only have 11 regular divisions in the regular army. Mm-hmm. All those replacement troops are coming out of the National Guard. Mm-hmm. Not once, but twice.
Right.
I can feel for them, but I won't do it again. There's some of these people in the United States, they don't know the meaning of the word patriotism. Mm-hmm. The only thing they know is that little shell they're living in. Well, that ain't what it's all about. Mm-hmm. Buying foreign cars is not a good idea. Mm-hmm. I told some of them, wait till the day you get your change in yen. Then what are you going to do? Because they're buying this country up. And they're buying our politicians. I said, I wouldn't. Roosevelt or Truman come back, I might. Patton come back, I would. They would get a chance. Everybody should go down and go through the Patton Museum.
Where is that?
Fort Knox, Kentucky. Mm-hmm. Sometime in your life, you should go see it.
Mm-hmm. No, I'll try to do that.
It's a beautiful drive down there.
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks again. Thank you for doing what you've done.
If I can help, call me.
Okay.